Good afternoon, everyone. Today's trades offered us, I think, a valuable lesson in terms of emotional management and trading psychology, so that's what I'm going to focus on in this video. Here's what the trades looked like setting up live, just so you can get a screenshot, and now let's contrast this with what the final result was. So looking at this, if I show you where that exact entry was, the S&P came as price breached our volatility box line, and the NASDAQ came as price breached our volatility box line on the other side of the charts. The Dow had already signaled to us that the scalper was more aggressive than usual in that first hour, so we knew that our focus should really be on the S&P and the NASDAQ. Now, if I zoom in first on the S&P chart, you'll notice that we had the edge signal come above our cyan line, which also meant that we had an opportunity to enter above the cyan line and reduce our risk. In fact, we were able to reduce that risk by 1.5 points, which ended up feeling really nice from the get-go. Now the question comes, do you use that 1.5 points to bump up your target, or do you continue to use the same target that you normally would have been looking at using the cyan line? Now my answer is to do the latter. It's to follow the trade plan rules, which is I got a better entry, which means I've been able to reduce the risk, but the target that I'm looking for is still based off of the cyan line, which in this case was 7 points, and our stop was outside of the volatility box where we've given it a little bit more room. So now the S&P hits our cyan line, you get the edge signal, we get our entry, get a better entry, S&P pukes, falls 6.5 points, falls 2 ticks shy of our actual target before price now starts to reverse. So now if you've been a volatility box trader for quite some time, this isn't all that unusual, right? So many times we've seen price reverse, hits the cyan line, then again you have that massive puke down lower, which ends up giving you that really, really nice run move down lower. Instead, in the case of the S&P futures, what ended up happening is we continued to chop sideways, and then we started to go up a little bit more. In fact, if I zoom out here, we came 2 ticks shy of our actual stop. So if you can imagine that in terms of emotional management, first, we fall 2 ticks shy of our actual target, then we come up to the point where you're 2 ticks away from the actual stop, and it's so easy at this point to obviously try and get ahead of yourselves, right? If we contrast this with the NASDAQ, at the same time, the NASDAQ is already stopped out. So on one hand, you've lost money, you see the S&P is still chopping sideways, and at that point, emotionally, it's so easy to think, hey, I'm getting an opportunity to get out at break even. You can do so and really save yourself from a potential loss, in which case you would have saved yourself from this heat. But now the question becomes, do you really re-enter since this trade is still valid for all intents and purposes? Now, if you follow the trade plan rules, did absolutely nothing, had a good grip on that trading psychology where, again, you're letting the probabilities play themselves out. It's not about what happens today. It's about what happens in the long run over a series of trades. That's the whole idea of the volatility box, is to look at this in a series of trades, keep recognizing that we're following the same process-driven approach every single trade, and we're going to let the probabilities play themselves out. So now if you touched nothing, then you were able to still get a really nice winner in the S&P, which helped to offset some of the losses in the NASDAQ. However, if you did adjust and you got out for break even, then you had just the NASDAQ losses with a plus zero on the S&P. Of course, that came without a good deal of stress in this heat, so I wouldn't say that it wasn't necessarily an easy decision. But again, if you're following the trade plan rules, it should be as easy as letting the trade set up. Once you get that trigger, the trade is valid. We set our conditional orders as brackets in which the stop is already there. It's a hard stop. The target is already there. It's a hard target. And you let the trade actually play itself out, right? That's where I think overmanaging and just looking at every single tick doesn't always help. In today's case, that was a pretty good example of the emotional management that was required in order to try and offset the losses and still end the day without really feeling a whole deal of pain. If you had taken just the NASDAQ trade, that was a minus $1,000 loss across both of the contracts, which again, not a small loss, but the S&P helped to make back 700 of that, right? So the end of the day was still a net negative, but you reduced that net negative down to negative 300 by sticking to the rules and thinking of this as a series of trades and following the rules. Now, if you had, again, tried to be too cute, to at least manage this trade, take your stop off at break even because you didn't either take your target off, then I think that's where you, again, tried to overmanage this. And today was a valuable lesson in why letting the trade plan work itself out, letting the probabilities work themselves out is usually the smarter idea. At least when you're trying to trade a system like the volatility box. That's the beauty of this. You get to do the same thing day in, day out, knowing that the probabilities are in your favor and knowing that the edge is stacked in your favor more times than not. When we lose, we manage our losses, we keep our losers small, and when we win, we typically have some really nice winners. In the S&P, if you take a look to see what that ended up actually looking like from that point of entry, That gave you a really, really nice flush move down lower, in which, again, once you hit our first target, our stop is at break even. This trade, for all intents and purposes, after we hit that first target, you can ride that second contract down for as low as you'd like, or even have a trailing stop. If we use our trend line tool to see what that max gain was in a very perfect, ideal scenario world in which you have a crystal ball, so far the S&P's fallen right around 30 points from our point of entry, in which you had risked right around 8 points. So that should give you an idea of what's possible with the volatility box, especially when you get some of these beautiful reversal opportunities. All right, so I hope that helps to give you an idea of what today's trading activity looked like, along with why trading psychology is just as important as the actual trade setup. We already have a trade setup in which we've proven that we have an edge. We prove that the probabilities are on our side, but the probabilities won't ever be in your side if you let your emotions get in the way and not let the probabilities work themselves out. All right, take care, good luck trading, and we'll see you in the next update.